Hello class, assalamu alaikum. This is the new chapter of transport, telecommunication and trade. So in this chapter we will first talk about industrial and trade infrastructure facilities in Pakistan, but before we discuss that, we first should know what exactly is infrastructure. So infrastructure is the basic system of services that a country or organization uses in order to work effectively. For example, we need a better transport system through bridges, roads and airports, right? We need a proper disposal of waste to a sewage system. We need a proper supply of water to water pipelines. And then we need a proper supply of energy like electricity through electrical grids. And we need a good telecommunication, right? So these all things are called infrastructures. Infrastructure can be the physical systems or the soft systems as well, right? So physical system basically constitute of things like pipelines and electrical grids, whereas we have the soft infrastructure as well, and the soft infrastructure basically consists of the law and order and the police stations, right? So infrastructure in short is basically the basic system and the service that a country needs to run effectively. Now let's talk about the technical structures that we have. We have roads, airports, bridges. So these three infrastructures are important for the transport to take place. Then we have water supply, which ensures that, you know, different parts of Pakistan, they get water. And then sewers to ensure that there's a proper disposal of waste. And then we have electrical grids to make sure that there's a proper supply of electricity and telecommunication, which help connect people to one another while sitting in different parts of the country. Now these technical structures, they support the growth of economy. These infrastructure facilities that we that I discussed in the previous slide, they are provided differently in different areas of Pakistan, right? So for example, Punjab has more infrastructure compared to Balochistan and other parts of the country. That is why Punjab is able to contribute more to the economy compared to the other parts, right? So wherever we have a better infrastructure, we see that there's a strong relationship of that better infrastructure with a better economic growth. Now, why exactly infrastructure results in a better economic growth? That's because, for example, if you have a good good system that will ensure that there's a proper supply of electricity or energy, then that means that more industrial machinery can work, right? If you have a good transport system and if you have a good law and order, then more tourists would love to come and visit your place, right? So it will increase tourism. Then if you have a proper sewage system, if you have a proper and healthy water supply, then that is going to make sure that all the people follow a healthy lifestyle. And then if you are well connected to the places within your country, this will increase the transport of the raw materials from the rural areas to the urban areas where we usually have industries, right? For example, if you have raw materials such as some wool of a sheep, then that wool, it can easily be transported to an industry in a city, which will then make clothes using that wool, right? So this is how the infrastructure plays a very vital role in an economic growth. These technical structures can be divided. Now, you know, we talked about these technical structures. Now let's put them in wider categories. So physical infrastructure connectivity. Physical infrastructure connectivity means that, you know, this infrastructure is able to connect to different areas such as roads, railway lines, airports, and seaports, right? And then let's talk about energy as an infrastructure. So when we have good oil, good and more oil and gas pipelines, and electricity grids that basically make sure that, you know, in different parts of the country, you're able to supply energy. And we all know energy is something very important for many processes to take place, especially in industries when we talk about the machinery, right? And then telecommunication, which for example, is a fiber optic that will allow that people living in different areas can talk to one another, right? And then soft, if we talk about soft infrastructure, then that basically includes effective laws and procedures that one follows. Now, there are other infrastructure facilities as well. For example, the soft infrastructure security, that is, we have proper prisons, fine protection, military office buildings and courthouses, you know, that ensures that there's a proper law and order. and then social services like hospitals, schools, and children protective services. Then we have cultural infrastructure as well. For example, museum, parks, and athletic stadiums. Now, in this chapter, we will specifically focus on physical connectivity, right? You should know the other type of infrastructures, but right now, in this chapter, we are just going to focus on physical connectivity. Now, physical connectivity such as roads, bridges, seaports, what they're going to do is that they're going to improve the domestic, regional, and international trade by ensuring that there's a smooth flow of goods and services and also people as well. Now, let's talk about roads first. So Pakistan's National Highway Authority is the authority which basically owns, that basically maintains and operates all the major highways in Pakistan. So an examiner can ask you that tell the name of the authority which is responsible for maintaining and operating the major highways in Pakistan. You should be able to answer it. You'll say that Pakistan National Highway Authority is responsible for this. Now, motorways and national highways are the major road systems of Pakistan. You know, whenever you travel from Lahore to Mari or to Islamabad, you get to know that you're passing through national highways such as Grand Trunk Road, which is called a GT road, right? So national highways include GT road, which is this, and then we have the Indus Highway, we have the Karakoram Highway, and we have the Makran Coastal Highway. So you should remember all the four major highways of Pakistan. Now, the problem is that we do have these highways, but the roads which can further connect to different rural areas are not there, right? We do have roads in cities, but we don't have enough roads in the rural areas. And remember, rural areas or the agriculture areas, they're basically the places from where the raw materials from many of the industries come, right? So if you're not going to have a good transport system over there, then it will be very difficult for the domestic and the international markets, because we will not be able to transport the crops from there, from the rural areas to the industries. Now, this is a map view of the roads, of the national highways and the strategic roads that we have in Pakistan. Now, Pakistan Railway is a state-owned national rail network in Pakistan. You know, for example, we have a Pakistan International Airline, which is PIA. Just like that, we have Pakistan Railway, which is a national railway, right? Which is owned by the government. So it helps in the large-scale movement of people and goods throughout Pakistan. That's called the lifeline of the country. So if somebody asks you that, why do we say that Pakistan Railway is a lifeline of the country, that is, the reason is that number one, it is able to transport large number of people from one place to another, and it is also able to transport bulky items from one place to another, right? For example, it will be really hard for you to transport a bulky item on an airplane from one place to another, right? Number one, it is going to be expensive, and number two, it is not going to be safe. Then important railway lines in Pakistan are Karachi to Peshawar, Rohri to Quetta, Khanewal to Faisalabad, Lahore to Faisalabad, and Lahore to Sialkot. So you should remember these railway lines that we have. Now, as we are discussing railway, let's get into the detail of what is a gauge. So gauge of a railway track is defined as a clear minimum vertical or the perpendicular distance between the inner faces of the two rails. So these are the two rails, and this is the perpendicular distance between the two rails. Now this perpendicular distance, or this width in another word, is basically called a gauge, right? So Pakistan Railways have a mixture of gauges, right? Sometimes the distance between the two rails is less, so we say that it is a narrow gauge. Sometimes the distance between the two rails, that is equal to 1,000 millimeters, so we say it is a meter gauge. And sometimes it is 1,676 millimeter, we say it is a broad gauge line. Remember, the broader the gauge, the more stable the train will move, right? So it is going to be much more safer, right? But the problem is that the more broader the gauge, the more expensive it gets. So if you have enough capital, if you have enough funding, then you can of course make the broad gauges. Okay, so now over the years, some narrow gauge and meter gauge has been replaced by the broad gauge lines. So gauge is basically a distance between the two rails. Now let's talk about the condition of railway equipment in Pakistan. So the railway equipment in Pakistan are not in very good condition. So most of the rails, so these are the rails, and these horizontal lines are basically called the sleepers. So these sleepers make sure that the rails are basically stable. So these rails and sleepers are in worn out condition. They are not in a good condition. Then this diesel locomotive, this steam locomotive and electric locomotives are also not in good conditions.